tremendous amount of enthusiasm here for Dennis Lilly's first over.
Ready, camera two. Take two. Give me a little camera three. Right, take three. Camera four, a wide shot. Stay on Lily, camera three. Yeah. Camera one, show the field. One. Batsman on two. Take two.
That's what he's after.
Coming to you, camera four. Take it. All right, good one, Dennis. Take three. Stand by slow-mo for the replay.
Lily has broken through the first wicket of this clash at West Indies.
The pressure back here is almost like being out in the middle.
Number five.
Cricket has been a particular pleasure for me. If you like, it has been my life. I make a good living from it, and yet it's never been a job or a chore. The game of cricket brings more pleasure to more Australians than any other sporting activity. As a nation, we are more likely to know the makeup of the national team than who represents us in federal cabinet. Cricket is a phenomenon in this country. I quote from the Australian Encyclopedia. Telecom's dialer score service gains more revenue from inquiries than each test team combined makes. In the 1970s, the English visits caused some 6 million calls to be made, even though radio and television provided full descriptions. Over 500,000 match quality cricket balls are made each year in Australia. Over 90,000 match quality bats are imported annually. There are over 400,000 active grade cricketers in senior, junior and country competitions. The world record for crowd attendance occurred in 1961 when 90,800 people saw Australia versus the West Indies at the MCG. Finally, 350,534 people over 6 days saw Australia play England in 1937. Today, with live broadcasts on television and radio, plus satellite, cricket is gaining in strength and popularity. Cricket's history is full of great names, great performances, and great games. This video, produced by my friends at the Sharp Corporation, is a fascinating record of the game. From its very beginnings in the old world, through the great names like Grace, Spofforth, Trumper, Bradman, up to the present. I hope this Sharp video, The History of Cricket, entertains you and increases your enjoyment of the game. Here's a post-war skipper I've known for a while, my brother Ian, to narrate the story for you.
Farewell to old England forever.
1788 was a busy year for cricket. The world's newest cricketing nation had just landed at Sydney Cove, although it would be 16 years before the first recorded cricket match. In 1788, on the other side of the world at St John's Wood, just outside London, a gentleman's club known as the Marylebone Cricket Club celebrated its first birthday. In this first year, the MCC set about revising the laws of cricket. The modern cricket era was underway, in England at least. Australia had some catching up to do when it came to cricket. Our history was just starting out. We were busy making new friends. For many of our cricketing forebears, those days were far too busy to indulge in such time-honoured pleasures. In the 5th century, the Jutes came from Europe to settle in the region now known as Kent and Hampshire. They brought a game with them that could explain the strong cricket followings of those counties today. The Vikings were great explorers and indulged in other pursuits apart from the well-documented stories of rape and pillage. The Vikings liked to relax at home and abroad, and in Ireland in the 9th century, they demonstrated a bat and ball game called Natalkerr. Cricket had come a long way by the 14th century. The name cricket could be traced to the Anglo-Saxon for crook, crook. The shepherds used their crooks to strike a ball, obviously when the wolf was laying low. As time marched on, so did cricket. Country boys bowled underarm to a handle gate of a sheep pen. The crossbar or bale could be dislodged and the batsman was on his way. In 1697, the first 11-a-side game was played for the stake of 50 guineas. By 1782, prizes had risen as high as 1,000 guineas. The first officially recorded game in Australia took place in 1804.
The late intense weather has been very favourable to the amateurs of cricket, who have scarcely lost a day in the last month.
Australia had begun to play, and in 1861 the first English side came to visit us. For many, this tour was a poor substitute for a cancelled lecture tour by Charles Dickens. The Englishmen, led by H.H. Stevenson, were given a grand welcome. They were opposed by teams made up of 15, 18 and 22 men. But Australia still had a lot to learn. A total of 13 ducks in their two innings of this match. A Dickens of a lesson. Another team came in 1863-64 under the captaincy of George Parr, a famous Nottinghamshire player. A third team in 1873-74 had as its captain the most famous cricketer of all, a young Dr. W.G. Grace. The doctor, or W.G., was on his honeymoon. The time for Australia to stand up and be counted arrived on March 15, 1877. Australia's first Test 11 was assembled to face an English 11. Only two generations had elapsed since the arrival of the first fleet. Australia, under Captain David Gregory, went into bat on Thursday, March 15, 1877. It wasn't just all cricket. It is reported that the most beautiful creatures in the colony paraded as close as permissible to the boundary flags. Was it the beauty parade or the occasion that inspired Australia's Charles Bannerman? Bannerman went on to make 165 of Australia's total of 245 before retiring hurt. England, in its first innings, fell to the bowling of Midwinter with 5 for 78. Midwinter's figures were surpassed by the English bowlers of Shaw and Ulliott in Australia's second innings. Kendall struck back for Australia in England's second innings, taking 7 for 55. To the astonishment of all but perhaps the Australian players, England had lost the first test by 45 runs. The greatest test of all actually came 2 days early of its centenary. It was March 12, 1977, at the World's Amphitheatre of Cricket, the Melbourne Cricket Ground. The English lineup was Woolmer, Brearley, Underwood, Randall, Amos, Fletcher, Gregg, the captain, Knott, Old, Lever and Willis. For Australia, Davis, McCosker, Cozier, Greg Chappell, captain, Hooks, Walters, Marsh, Gilmore, O'Keefe, Lilly and Walker. After 100 years, luck came England's way on the toss and Tony Gregg sent Australia into bat. The test of tests was underway. This was a test match of individual brilliance from many players. A young David Hooks made his name on this occasion.
Going to hook spinners around the wicket. And down the ground it goes. That's a great shot. That's almost a six. Over the fence or hitting the fence on the first bounce. That was almost a six through extra cover. Hooks is 40, 5 for 227.
Hooks is certainly not frightened to hit the ball.
And he's got that round towards fine leg. A chase round for Underwood. And it's going to be close. Underwood will get to it. No, he won't. Four more. Hooks is 44. And away it goes again. Beautiful shot. Three in a row. And the young man on his first test is 48. 5 for 235.
Well, certainly Hooks gets a 50 in this, his first test. It will be a notable milestone for him. Not only 50 in his first test, but a 50 in the centennial test.
And away it goes for his, could be his 50, out towards the boundary. A beautiful shot. Four in a row. Four fours off England's captain. 52 to David Hooks. A brilliant performance. a standing ovation right round this huge ground. And through again. It's racing out towards the boundary. It might get there. Let's see what happens. It's very close indeed. And the ball will win 5 in a row.
A great English bowler and a great Australian batsman match wits. There was bravery that will be talked about for another 100 years.
Again. Sean, he's pulled it on.
Hit him in the face.
He's hit him in the face. He's dragged it onto his wicket.
Well, that was a most unlucky dismissal.
Here's McCosker, swathed in bandages, with March approaching his century. Leave it to McCosker. And he's hooked the short ball. It's coming down to the boundary. And that will make it 8 for 387. It stumps on the third day.
England's Derek Randall played the innings of his life.
Good shot. Straight down the ground. That was another fine shot. Beautiful shot. Classic cover drive.
4 run to equal their first innings total. Great shot. Pulled away through mid-wicket. Very, very seldom, I think, that you see an Englishman being able to hook Lilly in front of square. Great shot by Randall. Moves on now to 42. And he's got the other way all right this time. Beautifully played, square on the offside. And just reaching the boundary, and that four bring up the 100 for England.
Oh, fine drive. Plays that shot so well.
Sterling fight back on the part of the England batsman. And much of it due now to Randall, who's on 87.
And they're going for a run. That's his 100. Magnificent effort. Randall, Derek Randall, 100 in his first test against Australia. And that's hit him on the head, a bad one. Bad one. And there's an appeal there.
It's a wonder he didn't fall on the wicket. Down he goes.
Lilly to Randall. Lilly to Randall. They're 3 for a single, and Randall, 150. Caught, is he? He's walked. He's gone. And a chance, he's out. It's all over. Marsh again, a brilliant catch. Marsh has taken 4 catches. England all out, 95. And Rod Marsh has broken Roddy Grout's keeping record with his 188th dismissal. Underwood to Marsh. And that's beaten the field. It's racing out towards the boundary, 3 points. 4 to Rod Marsh. And that's the other side of the ground. Away it goes to the mid-wicket area. There's a fieldsman there, but he won't reach it. Into the fence for 4. And that could be it. This is off the pad. They've gone through to 1. Let's see what happens. The umpire is indicating that's his 100. Rod Marsh has made history in cricket. The first Australian keeper, the only player so far in the centenary test. And that's 2 records he's broken in this very match.
That's it. It's LBW. Alan Knott is out. England.
There were many great deeds over those 5 days in March.
There by Lilly to see the end of England and Australia triumphing by a margin of 45 runs.
The great early names of cricket, like Dr. W.G. Grace, the Demon Spofforth, the stylish Victor Trumper, to even the casual cricket follower, are still familiar. However, names like Dick a Dick, Mosquito, King Cole, Tuppany, Tiger are not as familiar, yet their feats and place in Australian cricket history are assured. In 1868, an Australian Aboriginal team toured England. It was an arduous tour, lasting 126 days, with outstanding results for the proud new race of cricketers. Of 47 matches played, they won 14, lost 14, and drew 19. One batsman shone. His anglicised name was Jack Moolah. His tribal name, Muar Rinium. This was England's cricketer for all seasons. The master right-hand batsman. The skillful and tactical captain. The master of gamesmanship. W.G. Grace was the best-known Englishman of his era. He dominated the cricket scene at home and wherever he travelled. A great wit, he once refused to leave the crease when obviously out early in his innings. When pressed by the bowler, he responded,
"These people didn't come to see you bowl. They came to see me bat."
His run tally in first-class cricket was 54,896 at 39.55. He made 126 centuries. He took 2,876 wickets at 17.92 and took 877 catches. In his 22 tests, he scored 1,098 runs at 32.29 and captured 9 wickets at 28.22. His last test was in 1899 against Australia. The doctor was 51 years old. If the figures don't quite fit the legend, it could be because of the primitive conditions cricketers of the day played under. W.G. Grace loved cricket and cricket followers. His innings closed in 1915. One of Australia's greatest all-rounders, George Giffen, summed up the demon.
"What a sight to see Spofforth bowling when a game had to be pulled like a brand from the burning. And I verily believe he has frightened more batsmen out than many bowlers have fairly and squarely beaten."
Spofforth was Australia's first genuine pace bowler who took 853 wickets in his career at an average of 14.95. He played in 18 tests, taking 94 wickets at 18.41, a striking rate emulated by Dennis Lilly. His figures for the Ashes test at the Oval in 1882 were outstanding, 7 for 46 and 7 for 44. Spofforth retired to England and continued to be the demon until he was well past 50.
"He had no style, and yet he was all style," a keen observer wrote.
For many who saw Trumper in action, they rate him the greatest of all Australian batsmen. That may or may not be correct, but Trumper was certainly special. Victor Trumper kept his cricket simple. He rarely wore batting gloves and discarded the rubber grip. During the 1902 tour of England, Trumper made a century before lunch on the first day at Old Trafford, a feat only equaled three times since by Charlie McCartney, Sir Don Bradman and Majid Khan. Said Wisden,
"All bowling came alike to him, and he reduced our best bowling to the level of the village green."
And this from the same game.
"His cutting and off driving approaches perfection, and he did everything with such a grace of style that his batting was always a delight to the eye."
Trumper scored 16,939 first-class runs at an average of 44.57. He played in 48 test matches, accumulating 3,163 runs at 39.04, including 8 centuries. More often than not, he objected to teammates trying to attain a double century and would run them out, telling his disbelieving ex-partner it was time to give others a knock. The stumps were drawn for this wonderful man in 1915. He was only 37.
Don Bradman, every Aussie dipped his lid to you.
For many Australians, cricket starts with Don Bradman. He, more than any other Australian, has influenced the game at home and abroad. Bradman was a cricket phenomenon. No other player before or since has scored as often from the first ball received. His record is outstanding. He averaged a century every third time he batted, 117 first-class centuries in all, and only 15 first-class ducks. His highest first-class score of 452 not out has been surpassed only once. And Bradman was to become a great captain and a capable administrator. He was also very adept at other sports, including golf, billiards and tennis. He had the reflexes and the sporting instincts of a natural athlete. Bradman's tenacity and craft with the bat was carried into his fielding, mostly in the outfield or the covers. The legend started quietly enough. His debut test match was at Brisbane in 1928. He was 20 years of age. Bradman's scores were 18, LBW to Tate, and Court Chapman bowled white one. Australia lost by a monumental 675 runs. Perhaps it was the magnitude of this defeat for Australia, or an idle comment by English bowler Maurice Tate, who said to White,
"What do you mean by getting my rabbit?"
within Bradman's hearing. Whichever way Bradman took the remark, one thing is certain. He began to make England pay that summer of 1928-29. His first-class aggregate for the season was 1,690 runs at 148.83, and a low 12th man for the second test. Bradman scored centuries in the remaining three tests and averaged 66.85. The year was now 1930, and Bradman was the baby of Bill Woodfull's young Australian team that sailed to England. A side they dubbed the Children's Crusade because six of the players were under 23. The second test at Lord's in 1930 is on record as the most glorious cricket match ever played. It was this test that Bradman's batsmanship first shone like a sun over the summer of English cricket. Australia won the match by 7 wickets, with Bradman thrashing the English attack for 254. Bradman hit a century in the first test at Trent Bridge and a double at Lord's. However, his feat at Headingley Leeds is his most remarkable performance. Against the pace and aggression of Larwood and Tate, Bradman scored 334. He became the youngest player to score a triple century in tests, a record that remains to this day. It was the first time that a player had scored over 300 in one day's test match play. Bradman's reputation was gaining as fast as he could score runs. Harold Larwood said,
"He did all the things you didn't want him to do. He had the quickest eye of any batsman I ever met."
His score in Australia's Ashes-winning fifth test was 232. Bradman's aggregate for the series is still a record of 974 runs at 139.14. When the English team arrived in Perth in 1932, fast bowler Vose was asked about his team's chances. He ominously replied,
"Not a bad side, and if we don't beat you, we'll knock your bloody heads off."
England realised they faced a bleak period if they could not find a solution to the finest bat in the world. Perhaps they had. Bradman had looked uncomfortable against some quick rising balls on a wet wicket at the Oval. For 2 years, England had plotted what was to prove almost the downfall of cricket. Bodyline, or fast leg theory, was about to be launched against Bradman. The prediction of Vose was almost to come true. The first assault of fast leg theory ironically missed the batsman it was aimed at. Don Bradman was ill for the first test in Sydney. But Stan McCabe was there and recorded the highest score ever against bodyline. 187 not out, and not without pain and bravery. The bodyline tour was underway. Douglas Jardine, the England captain, was a great amateur of this period. His lofty airs and graces did not endear him to Australian crowds, nor his determination to win at any cost, especially as he was the architect of bodyline, with the 90-mile-per-hour deliveries being directed straight at the Australian batsman. Larwood is quoted as saying that they couldn't swing the ball away as bowlers can these days. After four overs with a new ball, the bowling would be straight up and down, and Bradman would murder straight up and down bowling. Bradman denies a weakness on the leg side, claiming his favourite shots were the hook and the pull, and that bodyline posed greater problems for older and slower players than it did for him as a young 24-year-old with fast reactions. Larwood found the harder wickets in Australia gave him an extra couple of yards over his performance on softer English wickets. His natural strength in his 5'8" frame developed from his early experience working as a coal miner. Australia's captain, Bill Woodfull, refused to use the same tactics. However, had he done so, it is suggested bodyline would have come to a natural demise much sooner. Relations between Australia and England were somewhat strained following England's 4-1 bodyline Ashes win the previous year in Australia. Bradman made another triple century at his favourite hunting ground, Headingley, in the fourth test. Ponsford scored 181. Rain brought an end to play, forcing a drawn match, and so the two teams went to the fifth test at the Oval with the series level at one match each. The Don played innings of 241 and 77. However, the highest score in the game came from Bill Ponsford with an unbeaten 266. Australia won by a mammoth 562 runs, avenging their loss of the Ashes the previous year. Bradman was elected Australian captain in 1936 and immediately made cricket history. Australia lost the first two matches in the series. Then a contribution of 270 runs from Bradman in the third test added interest to the rubber. The fourth test was vital if Australia was to square the series. Bradman contributed 212 and Australia won. History was made in the fifth test at the MCG when Bradman led his team to victory, the only captain to win a series after being 2-0 down. The 1948 tour side came to be known as the Invincibles. Miller really put his back into his bowling. But Linwall's action was much smoother. Bill Johnston, who took 5 for 36 at Lord's. Bradman, at 40 years, was playing in his last Test series and continued to be an invaluable ambassador for our country.
The Australians are going to try, as far as possible, to give you bright and attractive cricket. To do that, of course, it is necessary for both sides to cooperate.
Cooperation could not have been further from the minds of the English players as Bradman took the field on this occasion. Bowled for a duck in his last Test innings ever, 4 more runs and his Test batting average would have been 100 rather than 99.94. Perhaps the most exciting and satisfying Test series ever held in Australia occurred in 1960-61 between the West Indies, led by Frank Worrell, and the Australian team, led by Richie Beno.
The batsmen have been scoring at the flamboyant rate of 6 runs and over, and every Australian bowler has been punished severely. Sobers is in tremendous form, and Worrell, playing a captain's knock, is restraining his natural aggression to give his talented partner as much of the bowling as he can. Alan Davidson, both in fact and figures, is the best of the Australians, but he can't check the continuous flow of runs.
This sizzling straight drive takes the score past the 100, and even Beno has to applaud the brilliance of Garfield Sobers.
Sobers 100. After 3 hours of play, the West Indians are well ahead of the clock with 207 runs on the board for the loss of 3 wickets. Hall. The young giant cracks back and charges down the pitch. A collision. Down he goes and up to complete 2 runs with the whole ground in a state of pandemonium. Hall has established his reputation against fast bowling and the spinning ball has him guessing. Wesley Hall seems to be in trouble. The next ball from Klein. Hall, deceived by flight, stretches into the unknown. Grout whips off the bails and Hall is stumped for 50. Hall received a tremendous ovation for a remarkable half century which included 8 fours. A full toss right at McDonald's head. A fiery opening by the giant bowler. This is real Test match heat, with Hall bowling at express speed from the start. Here comes another thunderbolt, and McDonald almost gets an edge. The ball is coming to McDonald at 90 miles an hour, but the plucky Victorian opens the Australian scoring with 2 runs through the packed leg side field. Here comes Hall's answer to McDonald's first scoring stroke. A really vicious ball, straight at the batsman, and McDonald collapses in pain. The last over before lunch, and Hall finishes the morning session in typical fashion. McDonald and Simpson weathered 25 minutes of new ball violence, and the Australian supporters breathe sighs of relief as the players leave the field with the score at no wickets for 11. McDonald plays an uppish leg glance, and Hunt takes a brilliant catch at leg slip. McDonald is out, caught Hunt, bowled Sobers for 57, an innings which was rated by experts as one of the most courageous in modern cricket. In true Calypso style, play goes on with Valentine bowling to Mackay. Runs are coming quicker now, and Mackay sacrifices the strike as O'Neill is rapidly approaching his century. Australia is 68 runs behind the West Indies, and O'Neill, the other not-out batsman, is 125 at the moment. This is interesting cricket, with the Australians steadily drawing closer to a first innings lead.
Kanhai turns the ball to the onside for a single, and the West Indians have almost wiped out the Australians' first innings lead of 52. A few minutes after the adjournment, Alan Davidson captures the wicket of Kanhai, who's caught behind by wicketkeeper Wally Grout. Grout has now figured in 6 dismissals, and Davidson has now captured his 8th wicket for the match. The 5th and last day of the Test match. Paul and Valentine take 2 runs off the first over. They're not expected to last, but as later events proved, their stubborn stand against the best Australian bowlers paved the way for the remarkable climax to the Test match. Paul, clean bowled, and the West Indians are all out for 284. They have a lead of 232 runs, and Australia has just over 300 minutes batting time left to score the run.
Australia has lost 2 wickets for a meagre 7 runs as Hall bowls to O'Neill. Favell plays uppishly and he's out, caught by Solomon in the leg trap. Favell made 7 runs and Australia faces outright defeat with 5 wickets down and 186 runs still required to win. Hall has the splendid figures of 4 for 37, and both Mackay and Davidson have just arrived at the wickets. Worrell is the bowler, and the batsmen attempt to start an Australian recovery in a tense period of cricket. The bowler at the grandstand end is little Sonny Ramadan. Mackay beaten is clean bowled, and Australia, with 6 wickets down, is still 141 runs behind. Davidson and Benno rise to the occasion, and this is the start of a great partnership. A whole bumper, a vigorous hook shot, an obvious 4, 18 runs required. A push to leg, a suicidal run. They scamper home, 8 to win. In comes Hall, bowling to Davidson. He flashes his bat, it's almost a catch. Sobers the bowler. Benno plays the ball to mid-wicket. They start down the pitch and Davidson is run out by a magnificent return from Solomon. Davidson run out for 80. What a grand cricketer he is. 40-odd runs in the first innings and 11 wickets in the match. Now comes the amazing finish to the Test match with Wesley Hall bowling the first ball of the last over. They're going to run for anything. They sprint home for a single, and it's 5 to win. Back now with Hall for the second ball. Benno snicks, and he's out, caught by Alexander. The 8th Australian wicket has fallen, and either side can still win the match. Benno scored a splendid 52, and now it's left to Grout and Mekiff, with Lindsay Klein to follow. The third ball of the over. Ian Mekiff, the batsman. He reaches forward and drives, but there's no run. Hall bowling the 4th ball. Mekiff starts to run. Hall picks up and throws, but he misses a certain run out. The 5th ball. 4 runs to win. Grout swings, the ball goes high in the air. Hall races across and he drops the ball. A bad fielding error, and Australia needs 3 ones to win. The 6th ball. Mekiff connects and the ball flies deep in the outfield. They complete a 2nd run. The scores are level. The 3rd run will win the match. Grout makes a great effort, but the bails go off and he's run out. The scores are tied. 1 wicket left. Hall bowling the 7th ball to Klein. Mekiff is run out, and the match has finished in a tie. The first in Test history, and a fitting end to one of the greatest Test matches of all.
This was the 500th game of Test cricket played. A treasured moment in cricket was caught forever, and a topic of conversation amongst cricket followers was assured. A record crowd of 90,800 turned out on the first day of the final test in the series to see the West Indies. Such was the sentiment and appreciation for these sportsmen. However, the crowds disappeared in haste during this farcical cricket match, played in 1977.
Although it had been announced officially that the players would see the match through to the finish come what may, by now most of the crowd that had paid £35,000 had been driven to shelter. Swimming costumes would have been more appropriate than flannels, one thinks. Thompson found his rubber-soled boots something of a handicap. And suitably, the winning hit came from the bat of Greg Chappell, who finished with 125 not out. And immediately the players ran for the safety of the pavilion, good hot baths and dry clothes. The 1977 Prudential Series was over.
The sun was setting on the first era of cricket. A new era had arrived, and with it, promises of more colourful cricket. At first, the traditionalists stayed away in droves and said it could never last.
Gone for the hook shot, it's in the air. Willie's coming around from deep fine leg, and he's dropped it. And Shortney hooks that beautifully, gets inside the line, and he's nearly caught, and he drops it there. He's hooked this in the air. Dennis Willie again, what a hit, two out of three. He's got the three in a row, you wouldn't believe it. Dennis Willie again. Falls over. Oh, he's done his ankle too. He thinks he's run Barassi, for sure. He's taken over Melbourne. Look, he's got the mallet.
$25.
And here he goes.
And take one. Take
cricket
four.
Has changed. The players have changed, the crowds and the expectations. They've all changed. Cricket is a marvellously evolutionary game. It continues to grow, to develop, to win over its detractors when a change is first mooted. World Series cricket, or Packer cricket, or One Day cricket is part of cricket's evolution. With television and satellites, more people are seeing more cricket than ever before. Cricket has once again become an ambassador between nations. A cricket match at the MCG could now be seen live via satellite in England, India, Pakistan, New Zealand and the West Indies, and a host of other nations. I am often asked, will we see the likes of Spofforth, Trumper, Bradman, Sobers, Hammond, W.G. Grace, Larwood, Miller and others like them again? For my money, they are playing now. The competition's more athletic, the bowler's faster, and our judgments are tougher. Some examples.
Take four.
Let's look at Bradman and the player they call the Black Bradman. Don Tallon was a great, Rod Marsh is a great. Let's look at two of the greatest all-rounders, Sir Garfield Sobers and Ian Botham. And two bowlers we can still spin yarns about, Bill O'Reilly and Derek Underwood. What about Larwood and Lilly? Cricket has changed even for umpires. From when a Bradman was LBW, only the umpire knew for certain. His word was final. Today, a nation can see an umpire's decision many more times over and seven times slower. Well, that's cricket. I hope you've enjoyed the Sharp Corporation's brief but entertaining look at some of cricket's history and heroes.
Don Bradman, every Aussie dipped his lid to